Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Born2BNerd Podcast. My name is Ethan.
I am Lance.
And today we're going to talk about some nerdy stuff. Lance, what do you want to talk about today?
So, two big things happened over the course of these last couple of weeks.
What happened?
The biggest topic that I want to go over is we finished, you know, the second and final season of Arcane.
Yeah.
Made a big impact in the U.S. and worldwide.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to talk about
it,
that.
It was pretty high on, I think it was like number one for a minute on Netflix's.
Yeah.
Viewed.
Yeah. So I want to talk about that. Talk about the show as a whole, the production of it, the, you know, just the kind of the concept of it being a adaptation or a reimagination of video game lore, things like that, you know, kind of a just all encompassing Arcane talk for a bit. And then just another little docket is we're watching Dandadan at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
And a couple of weeks ago, we got episode 7, which was a pretty big episode in terms of being emotionally charged.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of threw a lot of people for a loop as far as being a very different episode than what the series had been so far.
We haven't talked about that. Like emotional complexity for the show.
Yeah. So we haven't talked about Dandadan, but we can talk about it a little bit, but I kind of want to go over episode 7 and how impactful that episode was in kind of the full scope of anime right now, especially like this year. And
I mean, I think it's the biggest one out right now. I think it's the most, the one getting the most, not only like a popular, like a hype, but it's getting the most like critic accolades as well.
Yeah. I think it's worth discussing in its uniqueness. So.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, and that's kind of it for today.
All right. Well, let's fucking dive on into Arcane. I finished it 3 or 4 days ago. No, that's a lie. I finished it 2 days ago. I had watched.
You didn't finish season one.
No, I never finished season one. I was working on Guardians at that time, and my life was kind of very chaotic, and I didn't have the emotional bandwidth to stick with the show. And so a lot of stuff, that whole 2022, the year 2022, a lot of shit just fell through the cracks. And that was one of them, Arcane. I started it and then never finished it and then just forgot about it. And I didn't even know they were doing a season two until it dropped. And I know you were really, really hyped on it. And I remember you saying that you really liked the show. So I was like, oh yeah, well, I'll pick it up. And then it hit, you know, it hit with everybody else on Netflix when it dropped. And so I was like, oh, okay, well shit, I guess this is like worthy of like the social zeitgeist of, you know, topics to talk about. And then like some kind of things started going on. I don't know. I feel like the reviews are mixed for it. I tried not to read it anything about it before I watched it because I was trying to form my own opinion.
Right.
Because I think you enjoyed the show more than I did. I really liked the show. I never loved it, if I'm being honest. Like I did. I really liked some parts of it, but there were a lot of storytelling techniques that I really don't agree with.
Okay.
And we can talk about it as we go on. But let's talk about like what we actually liked about the show, first of all. And like this is an all-encompassing review and discussion about it. So if you guys haven't watched any of the Arcane 1 through 2, like there's going to be a lot of spoilers. So you might want to skip on ahead or pause this, finish the episode, and then come back and listen to this. Or finish the season, come back and listen to this, because lots of spoilers.
Yeah, it's going to be all-encompassing.
Yeah.
I mean,
and also ahead to Dandadan. When we're talking about that, it's also going to be spoilers up to episode 7 of season 1. So, I guess let's talk about like what we like about it first. You start.
So I thought personally, I thought season one was a masterpiece.
Okay.
I gave it a 10 out of 10.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Cinematically, like character design, plot design, story direction. I thought it was basically perfect, honestly, in season one. I even to this day can't really see anything in season one that I feel is a flaw.
Mm.
I just thought it was like absolutely masterfully done, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Season two, extremely mixed feelings. I think a lot of people have mixed feelings. And I think the industry has more to do with that than the actual writers. And we can get to that in a minute. But
the animation industry? Or what industry do you mean?
The like entertainment industry.
Okay, hold on.
Yeah.
Can you hear my dog?
I can, yeah.
Okay, hold on. Hold on. All right, sorry about that. You were saying the industry?
Yeah. Well, we can get into that in a minute. The biggest thing for me was we haven't gotten many American. Is it American made?
Yeah.
I can't remember. There are some like French influences, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think there's some Canadian. I think it's a Canadian production company. Kind of like how like Funimation was doing back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
I think I could be wrong, but yeah.
I would, but I guess the question is, do we classify this as an American animation?
It's Western.
Well, because we don't have that many that stand out, right? We have
Avatar.
Yeah, that's the one that everyone always talks about.
And then the Warner Brothers stuff of the 90s, the Batman animated cartoons, the Justice League, stuff like that.
Right. I don't know if they have the legacy, though, long running, apart from like the, you know, kind of Marvel DC fans that continue to.
I'd say Batman, the 91 series, definitely does. That's like one of the most highest rated animated series like of all time. Yeah.
But, you know, we still didn't fill up a whole hand with.
Right, exactly.
With titles, you know. Mm-hmm. And that, I feel like that is very concerning when it comes to American animation. You know, like we got to step up our game. But I think Arcane made it onto this list of being kind of, you know, I think it's going to go down in history as a wonderful animation that the Western world put out that competes with some of the biggest animated titles out there. And I think the unique animation style of it is one thing that is going to be studied for sure. You know,
you mean the 3D aspect of it, like the Clone Wars aspect of it, or
yeah, I don't really know
the color palette, or what do you mean?
Well, I just mean the type of art style that it's drawn in, the mixture of 2D and 3D, but mainly the actual art style of the world, you know, of the universe that it takes place in. This I don't know how to explain it. It's the line art is very unique. The amount of detail in it is really unique.
I'll say for that style of animation, I think the color grading for it and the attention to like shadow work.
Yeah.
Is definitely steps above things, something like Clone Wars, which is a similar animation style. I think that the movement in this show was really, really, like really, really well done.
Right. And the expressions.
Yeah. Oh, no, exactly.
They've done expressions better than any animation I've ever seen, I feel like.
I wonder sometimes, too. I was like, there were a couple of times where I was like, is this mocap? Like with the facial registration, I was like, that's kind of like, wild.
The subtle eye movements, like the little like that just give like little subtle emotion changes. You don't see that in animation.
No. You know? And there was this thing that Jinx did a couple times where her lip, it wasn't a quiver. It was like, it would just move.
Her little smirk.
Yeah. And I was like, damn, like that's really good.
Well, this show's attention to detail is astounding, that to the point where I'm still like, you know, I got the Arcane TikTok all over my feed, and it's just pinpointing all these little details that the writers and illustrators added to the story that like went unnoticed, and I just keep discovering new things, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, like season one, you have all these moving parts, all these moving characters, but the goal is pretty much singular. You know, you have these two nations, Piltover and the potential Zaun. And Zaun is like this undercity that's being neglected by its government and is trying to
form its own government.
Right, exactly.
In response, yeah.
Yeah. And then, you know, you have these like simultaneous, you have these small things happening, whether it be, you know, Jason and Victor's ambition with the Arcane, the governing bodies that are like trying to change the and shift power. And then you have, you know, some like more like crime related things happening in Zaun, you know, but the story is pretty singular in its direction from start to finish. And then season two, it kind of became something greater. But I loved watching the development of this story as it went along. It was just captivating from beginning to end. Seeing where each character started and ended was really cool. And I found myself like loving every character, you know. I think they did a great job with character development.
Yeah.
Or character design.
Character design. And and development. A lot of the character story arcs for me, like they were fulfilling. A couple of them, I felt like they were kind of thin isn't the right word. I feel like they weren't fleshed out enough. Like there was more that could have been done that just wasn't. And I think that's probably because there was so much going on. There were certain points where I was like, in the first season, where I was like, it feels like these are two completely separate stories and they're being told in the same time. And it would be so jarring sometimes when they would go from Zaun to the capital city.
Piltover?
Yeah, Piltover. And it was there were like two completely, I mean, there were some times where I was like the stuff with Jace and
Victor?
Victor.
And I call him Arthur a lot too. I don't know why.
I keep doing it. And the council and all that stuff. And then there was like the stuff with Silco and Jinx and the gangs down below. And sometimes it did kind of weave and go. But then other times it felt like there was a divide for me. I don't know. In the second season, it's all intermingled, especially like towards the last like two episodes of the first season. It starts to stack together. And then by season two, it's all, you know, intertwined.
Well, I've said this to people already, but I think season two should have been broken up into more seasons. Mm-hmm. I don't think season two should have been as compact as it was. Mm-hmm. I think everything was rushed. I think every story was cut in half and every plot point was shrunk to like fit within the episodes.
Yeah. I mean, when you have like I'm not exaggerating, like eight montages in one episode in a 40 minute episode.
Yeah.
That's what happens.
Yeah. You know, I remember I didn't know that season two was going to be the final season when I started it.
Yeah.
And once I finished Act One. Mm-hmm. I finished Act One. I remember telling my brother, I said, this is feeling like it's becoming a Game of Thrones level universe. You know, they started introducing all these different kind of, not necessarily factions, but kind of factions where you had,
You had, the what's her face's mom?
Ambessa.
Yeah. And then you had, and then even with that, you had like the stuff of the Black Rose.
Yeah, the Black Rose, exactly, like, which, coming into play.
Which, that's one of the, I'll say it's a negative for me. It was like, that was something that was like, that's really fucking sick. And I mean, I think grand total, it might have like 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Total screen time of like any consequence of the whole show.
For sure.
And I was like, how are y'all just going to, A, take this character who is a pivotal character, and basically her whole storyline was condensed down to like 4 minutes.
Yeah.
And I was like, bro, come on.
Well, let me, I will say, okay, this is, I didn't say an official opinion. Mm-hmm. Season one, in my opinion, is a masterpiece. I thought it was perfectly done. Me personally, I was able to follow everything really well. And I think how they navigated that story was perfect. Mm-hmm. And then I think season two completely, I don't think season two is bad, but I do think that I think it was very good. I think season two was very good. And yet I think it ruined the legacy of the series as far as like what it could have been.
Yeah.
I think it was brilliant. And I know that they're trying to do these spinoff series that could potentially make it feel less of a rushed arc per se and feel like it's just a busy season two to whatever grand series we get, you know, of these spinoffs.
Right, yeah.
But they didn't write it like that. And I'm not a huge fan of how it was written in terms of direction. I think the writers, like the amount of imagination and creativity and thought that I think was done with the writing is amazing. I think it's the industry that cut them.
Cut their
ability to stretch it out and form what could have been an absolute award-winning series, you know?
Yeah.
Which it could still be an award-winning series, but, for me, I think season two had some major flaws in its direction. I think direction is the biggest hindrance of the series. I think everything else is brilliant. I think it's the direction that kind of, because they had the storyboarding years ago, you know, they did the storyboarding like,
yeah, I heard they started like 8 years ago. Yeah. They started it. Yeah.
Yeah. I think the story was fleshed out, and I'm assuming it was just absolutely like crystal clear. And I can only imagine how detailed and elaborate it was.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think the direction is what just absolutely just shredded that thing to pieces.
Yeah.
But that's just my personal opinion.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's probably like you're talking about, like with Game of Thrones, it was like George told HBO and Dave and Dan from the beginning, he was like, if you want to do this right, you need 10 seasons. Like,
yeah,
you have to have 10 seasons.
Yeah.
And they were like, fuck off, we're going to do it in 7. Mm-hmm. And then they were forced to do 8. And he kept telling them, like, you need 10. They did 8. And then the last two seasons, I enjoy 7. 7's good. But it's not like 6.
Yeah.
And before. Because yeah, there was, you could tell they're condensing a lot.
Right.
And then by the time you get to 8, you're like, what? How? Like, how is this happening? Yeah. And for me, I'm going to tell you some of my problems with the show.
Sure.
Okay. I really like the show. The voice acting, dog.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. And I didn't know some of the actors as I kept on like texting you, where I'd be like, wait, who is this? And you'd be like, oh, by the way, he does this. By the way, home dude from Game of Thrones does this. And I'm like, like, holy shit. Found that Cho Chang was Caitlin. I'm just like,
who's Cho Chang?
Harry Potter.
Oh,
his love interest from the fourth movie.
Is her name Cho Chang in Harry Potter?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. I was like,
yeah. But I mean,
it's been a long time.
What's her face from Yellow Jackets and Fallout as Jinx?
Oh yeah.
My God. I forget her name. Hannah something? Is it Hannah?
Yeah.
She's so good. The way that she does the cracks in her voice sometimes, dude, and it's not forced, or it doesn't seem forced. It's like that's just good acting.
Yeah.
Haley Steinfeld, who I'm not like a crazy fan of, she fucking killed it as Violet. Yeah. Like she did so good at showing like the vulnerability and like the sternness and the power behind her.
Right.
The assertiveness of some of the scenes she had, but also like this weakness. Anytime that she had like a interaction with Powder or Vander, like anytime she was like talking to Vander, it was like, oh my God.
I think she surprised me as being someone that I can see that has a voice for animation.
Yeah, I never thought about it either.
And I like she turned that character into a character that, I mean, all of them are characters that I can't really see being played by any other voice actor.
Mm-hmm.
Like the League of Legends actual like in-game character Vi, like to me, I can't even see that as Vi now. Like,
really?
I feel like Haley, right? Haley
Steinfeld. Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like she created like her version of Vi became so much more real than anything else. And I think she did a really good job.
Yeah. I mean, I think overall they did a great job with like character building, with character progression, character development. You had people doing arcs. Like, I love Victor. I think Victor is probably my favorite character in the whole show.
Yeah.
Just because of everything that he goes through, where he starts, where he ends up, how his goals are changing. And then it's like, I mean, his entire being is changed throughout the series, you know, and where he is at the end as like a god, basically putting everything else in motion. It, like I loved it. And then, but then like you had Jinx, and I don't play League of Legends. So I don't have this, like, I think that's another reason that I don't have this like love for it. Like I know like some people do just because they played the game. Like whenever they would introduce characters, sometimes I knew based on just because of how they were introducing them that I should know who these characters are, but I didn't because I don't play the game. And I knew that if I had played the game, it would have been similar, like when the MCU first started going. Right. And I remember the first time watching Thor and they were like calling the Hawk and, or like, is the Hawk there or whatever they say. And it just shows, Jeremy Renner's hand on a bow. Yeah. And I was like, they never say Hawkeye. They just say the Hawk, and it shows his hand on the bow and that's it. And I was like, oh my God. You know what I mean? I'm like losing my mind. Mm-hmm. And that's how other people were feeling watching this. I know they were, because it's these characters these champions they've spent hours and hours with throughout their life. And I never had that connection to it. Right. And even with that, I really liked it. But one of the biggest things that I always say is like show, don't tell whenever you're making a series, right? Like that's the biggest thing in storytelling. Show, don't tell. In this case, they showed way too much, way too often.
Mm.
So in season 2,
you know, I agree.
Every single episode starts with a 3-minute music video.
Yeah.
Every fucking episode. Soviet montage is great. It's one of the greatest techniques ever developed for storytelling in cinema. But when you use it 7 times in an episode, 5 times at least every episode, dog.
Yeah.
Come on. Tell me the story.
Yeah.
Like, tell me, like, let the conversation and the dialogue and the consequences of what's happening emotionally play out on screen. Don't give me a 3-minute music video to Imagine Dragons every goddamn episode.
Yeah.
Like that. I'm sorry, but that it pissed me off. Like it really did. There were some times when I was watching season 2 where I was like, fucking hell. All right. I guess I'll just like listen to this song that I don't want to listen to.
Yeah.
And watch like lazy storytelling. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to watch to a lot of really bright, vibrant colors, which is another thing. I think that they pandered so much to Fortnite generation's obsession with the bright colors.
Mm-hmm.
Dog. I was like, again, that's very aesthetically pleasing and it's very useful when you use it correctly. But when you're using it all the fucking time, it just starts to bleed. It bleeds into everything and it becomes inconsequential.
Yeah.
And I was like, that paired with all the montage stuff, I was like, you guys are killing this show. Like when it finally does have these breaks, I think in the last episode was the longest time that I remember them not doing like an actual montage of fighting. And it actually mm-hmm. either showed the fights or it showed conversation. And you got these really nice interactions with the characters. Like, I forget there was the speech that Victor gives Jace when he says, he's talking about the price of perfection.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's like, the price of perfection is the pursuit.
The end of pursuit.
The end of pursuit. God damn. It's like, that's such a good line. It's so good. And they had opportunities to do things like that throughout the series in the second season. And they didn't, because they just skipped over it. And it's like, it's skipping over so much time too. That's what, another thing that I hated about it. And where you're talking about it, it felt like it was rushed. It's because it was.
Yeah.
I mean, there were points where I was like, how much time has passed in this 4-minute video that I just watched, this 4-minute short? How much time has actually passed? Because, you know, certain characters are in places and it's like everything literally looks different. And I'm like, how am I supposed to know the consequence of what just happened? You know, when you're just showing me like really fast, really like slow motion, like extreme slow motion, and then boom, like really fast, like Zack Snyder style cuts to set to, you know, whoever the fuck artist is playing in the background. And it just bummed me out, man. It bummed me out and it pissed me off, because I think that show was better than that. I think that whoever the showrunner was, or if it was Netflix or whoever it was that greenlit that, that pushed for that, should be fucking fired.
Yeah. You know, I think
I'm going to be really mean right now. Whoever said that, whoever greenlit that, should be fired. And anyone else under them who was like going in that direction should also be let go, because that people who make those kind of decisions are not creatives. People who make those decisions are people who only see one thing, and that's money. And it's ruining cinema.
Yeah. That's what I was going to say, is it feels like from what we got in season one, you could feel that like the writers and the creators were like, they were putting their heart and soul into it.
Mm-hmm.
And then season two, it feels like the industry stepped in and made them make these changes and adjustments to try to become more popular and try to like, you know, get more attention.
They upped everything.
Yeah.
Like they upped the soundtrack budget. Good God. I don't even know how much they paid for all the songs in that thing.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm talking about with like all the bright colors, you can use like that imagery in your shot to enhance the shot. But when you're using it so much, you're not using it to enhance the shot. You're relying on it as a crutch.
Yeah. Well, it's like, and in season one, like, yes, there are still some of those like montages throughout season one. But I feel like a lot of them were placed with a reason, right? So like Echo versus Jinx, the fight on the bridge, mm-hmm. where it switches to that music video.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like showing him kind of envision this battle between two like little kids like playing.
Yeah. That was beautiful.
Yeah. And it's like it's technically kind of like a music video, but it's kind of like his imagination. Like, you know, he's like picturing this like epic kids fight, but it's like showing the relation to that. And actually two people who used to be really close fighting for real,
mm-hmm.
you know, and like it has a purpose. And then I feel like episode one of season two, like, we're finally like seeing the aftermath of the explosion, and it's like brutal, and you're like, oh my God, this is crazy. And then boom, music video, we're in a wake, and you're just like,
oh yeah, dog, when that happened, I was like, what the fuck is going on right now? Yeah. Like, you have all this opportunity to actually encompass grief and like really deliver emotionally to your audience, and you're choosing to use whoever the fuck they use. And I'm like,
and it was, was just a bunch of shots of people walking around and like, just nothing. Like, Caitlin just lost her mother, and like they could have made that so much more impactful to see, actually see her. It's just, it bugged me. It bugged me really bad, where it just felt like they were just, it was clearly just put in there to, you know, I love that they're celebrating different art styles in those moments and like celebrating music, but it doesn't feel as much of a celebration as it is at like a ploy, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I thought it felt cheap.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's another thing that I really dug about some of the show, like, is they did use different art styles throughout it in different segments.
Mm-hmm.
And there was the one towards the end, maybe it was in the second to last episode, or maybe it was the last episode. It's basically like when they go to watercolor. I think it's when, who's the little girl when Isha. She, yeah, when she tries to kill Vander in yeah. the beast form and sacrifice.
It's like showing like a kid's view yeah. of like her like memories with yep. Jinx.
That was beautiful. That was yeah. really well done.
But that was incorporated into the storytelling. It was practically the same scene as that echo scene that I was describing.
Yeah.
Where it's like the purpose of the music video
is to enhance the emotion behind it.
Yeah. And it's showing like, it's kind of like showing like her living out this, or like these, you know, this child's imagination / memory of her and this special person.
Yeah.
But it's through the, like through the imagery of like a kid's imagination.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes like, it's a representation and it's like artistic and
yeah.
Yeah. So good.
Yeah.
And like season, or the best episode, in my opinion, of second season is episode
the flash or the alternate.
Yeah. Echo. Yeah. And because mm-hmm. that one doesn't have much music. I think it only has no. one music scene, which is the dance, which is perfect.
The dance. Yeah. Yeah. Is it the same as the
spin the wheel?
Doing the spin the wheel? That's yeah. the same song?
Mm-hmm. No, it's a different song. No. It's a different song, but it's, yeah, those two songs are in the episode. But
yeah,
that's the only, but yeah, and that's the best episode in the season, in my opinion, because it focuses more on the storytelling.
Mm-hmm. It focuses on the emotion driving every scene in that episode.
Yeah.
Like, and even like, even the music that they use felt more intentional than the music that they use throughout the show. Mm. Like you have that, it's like a French kind of soul R&B rap song
mm-hmm.
that plays in the club, in the mm-hmm. bar while they're dancing. And it's like, it's perfect for that whole vibe of that scene.
Yeah.
And then you have that really heartfelt folky song that Heimerdinger, is that his name?
Heimerdinger? Yeah.
People
call him Heimerdinger.
Heimerdinger?
Yeah.
Yeah, that he plays while he's on this little banjo thing.
Yeah. I think that song, this is, well, I want to save this.
Before you say this, I'm going to say this. That, in my opinion, that's the Hyro. That's the little soldier boy, the little drummer boy.
What's that?
In Avatar, where Hyro's singing to his son.
I got you.
Yeah, that to me, because they used the voice actor to do it.
Right.
And that, you hear the little breaks and stuff in his voice, and you hear like he puts the character in the song.
Yeah.
And I don't know. There's intent behind it. Mm-hmm. It's really, really.
Yeah. I want to talk about the actual rushing and like kind of the impact that had on the storytelling of season two. Cause you know, I really feel like it should have been, Netflix, I think, gave them 5 seasons.
Oh, really?
And they
chose to do that?
Yeah. Because they wanted to do these other spinoff series.
They were initially going to give Arcane, just Arcane, 5 seasons.
I think Netflix greenlit Arcane for 5 seasons.
Well, then that's fucked.
Yeah.
Yeah, whoever the showrunner is should 100% be fired.
Yeah, it definitely should have been at least three seasons. But I could have seen them dragging it out but extending it to 5.
I think 3 would have been perfect.
Yeah, yeah. I think the story, in my opinion, I think season two should have ended at Isha's sacrifice. I think it's symbolic, kind of a symbolic represent, like mirror of season one. Cause she kind of did the same thing that Powder did at the end of episode three.
Yeah.
And it kind of like completely
it's
abrupts.
It's a hard cut.
Yeah. It's a hard cut. It completely abrupts everything that everyone was doing in that moment and resets where like the next episode, everything's kind of being reset again. So I think they could have taken that and then have everything up to that point extend throughout the entire season. So we got more of everything else that was going on within that year without Echo, Heimerdinger, and Jace.
Mm-hmm.
And then season three, we open up with like the flashback of this previous year of what Echo and Heimerdinger and Jace experienced leading into the finale of the series. I think that's how they should have done it. That would have given them enough time to expand on every detail that they needed to expand on, you know?
Yeah.
What do you think got the least amount of attention that it deserved in terms of like story with this show?
It's weird because I think that they did like a good enough job with it, but I think they kind of missed the boat with like expressing the love that Jace had for Victor and their relationship and like the, cause towards the end they were like, he says like, we need to destroy it. That's what he was like, why are you trying to destroy this? And he's like, because that's what you told me to do. But that was so far long ago that they had this discussion and there's nothing really connecting them up to that point after that. I don't know. I felt like there should have been more between those two to help really boost the impact. I mean, it was an impactful moment at the end, but it could have been more so. And it's weird also to say that I wish there was more with Violet and Jinx, but
yeah.
I wished because that's kind of what the whole thing revolves around. Mm-hmm. But I wish there was. It seems like there's like a hard break where you're missing that. It seems like they were together for a while and they've reforged their sisterhood. They've reforged their bond. And then but it was literally like 15 minutes.
Right.
And so I don't know. I feel like we were kind of robbed of that build up.
Well, we were literally robbed of a lot of stuff. For instance, they said that the final episode was supposed to be an hour longer.
Like it was supposed to be a movie?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
They announced one of the creators did a live stream after the finale.
Yeah.
And he talked about how they had 60 minutes of extra footage of Jinx and Echo reuniting and like what they did in that time to like help.
See, I was going to say that. That was my favorite. Like if you were going to give more time, give Jinx and Echo, not even like main universe, main timeline, Jinx and Echo, but the alternate, let that breathe. Cause that was such a nice respite of the pure chaos and everything else. Mm-hmm. Like let that breathe.
Yeah.
Like, I really wish I could have gotten more of that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, everything should have gotten more everything, but they literally had more footage of Echo trying to like help Jinx come out of her funk and helping her come out of her funk by like, they said that the creator revealed that after that scene that we get in the final episode,
when he comes back and he stops her from killing herself like five times. Okay.
Yeah. They announced, like he talks about how like after that Echo tells her like his experience in the other realm that he tells her about Powder, about how like Powder was happy. Everyone was alive, like everything was good.
Yeah.
And like how clearly Powder / Jinx wasn't a rotten tomato or a rotten egg or whatever. It was just a bad
series of circumstances.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And he helps her. And then they spend the rest of the time, who knows what, partying, like having fun, inventing things, building the weapons that they use, building the ship, painting each other, probably making out a couple times, you know, like who knows, but they had the, they had it, they made it, they wrote it.
Well, I remember seeing, I remember thinking that whenever, in that episode, whenever, cause she disappears, like he does that. And then he, they like disappear. When she shows up, it's like she just dropped a bunch of ecstasy and a little bit of, and like snorted a little bit of coke, and she's just fucking, wow, she's ready to fucking go.
Yeah.
And it's like, where's, she was just literally about to kill herself, dude.
Yeah.
Like, can, like, where's the connection here?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And I'm,
I remember, like,
Yeah, they had that. They had that. Yeah. And it's really unfortunate that we didn't get it a lot. Like, Savika, that was Silco's right-hand man, or right-hand woman.
Oh, yeah, with the arm. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's missing the left hand.
Yeah.
But there's more footage on her to give her, like she should have got, she got a whole title screen cover.
Yeah.
Because she was supposed to be fleshed out character with a backstory and everything.
I mean, like, in the end, she was a freaking council member.
Yeah.
And it's like, and she was also leading the rebellion at one point when Jinx was MIA.
Right.
Like, give me something. Like, she's got something going on.
Yeah. I don't know. They didn't show her conflict enough, like her internal conflict, because what we saw from Savika was that she was, had great ambitions, mm-hmm. and she was loyal, you know, loyal to Silco, loyal to the idea, the ambition of Zahn, yet extremely, extremely stubborn in her ability to work with others. Right. So like whenever they were trying to, whenever Jace did that call to action, I was like, we all have to band together. She left, you know, and we didn't get to see why she chose not to work with them. We didn't get to see like what she was going through. It just made her look like a jerk. And then she shows up later and then she gets put on the council. It's just like, where's all the connections? Mm-hmm. You know what, where is this character coming from? Cause you're just making her seem like a, like you're making her kind of feel like a loser. And clearly like she's shown these moments throughout the series where that she's like really cares.
Yeah.
You know, like, well, they did she that hated Jinx and she still wouldn't turn her in whenever they were like,
right. Yeah, exactly. And then there's also the thing with like the, like same thing with the Fireflies, right? Like the Fireflies were in that council meeting too. And they dipped. Yeah. And then all of a sudden they show up at the end with Jinx. And it's like, I can see somebody in a board meeting being like, what if we don't show and we leave it for the surprise?
Yeah.
Like we leave it for the surprise. And that's probably how the conversation went.
Yeah. Let's just talk about my least favorite aspect of the entire show. Mm. And that is what they did to Jinx at the end.
The very end?
Or yeah.
Like so, the self-sacrifice or what?
Yeah. So they had this emotional scene where Jinx sacrifices herself to save her sister in the classic like fall trope kind of thing. And then they snuck a little hint. They snuck a little hint to show that she like whenever there's the explosion, there's this little pink trail that darts away.
Oh, I never even saw that.
Yeah. I've watched so many videos. Hmm. So in that explosion, right before her grenade explodes, you see this little pink stripe that just shoots off the screen.
Oh, yeah.
Clearly indicating that most likely that was her using her shimmer ability to like get out of the explosion.
Yeah.
Then it later shows Caitlin looking through her system that shows like the air ducts and stuff.
I remember seeing the air duct thing. I remember seeing that, yeah.
The reason they were showing that is to show because she has Jinx's grenade head, which means that they went down to the
to try to find her,
and all they found was a grenade head.
Yeah.
So she's clearly thinking about it, and she's looking, and she sees there's an air duct that leads out right where they found, or they didn't find Jinx.
Yeah.
And then she smirks, like, oh, I see now what she did. Yeah. And then it shows...
at the very end, it's that little flicker thing.
Yeah, well, it shows the air blimp flying, which is what Powder said in episode one, I'm going to fly one of those one day. And it's almost the exact same shot of that blimp.
Oh, okay.
And then it shows Jinx save the end, meaning like I'm saying this is the end. There's no more.
Yeah.
But why? Why make something so clear yet so secretive at the same time if it's the series finale? Yeah. If it was a cliffhanger leading into a new season, sure. But this is a series finale. Like, these people, like, the audience isn't going to get any more.
I mean, unless they are. Like, they say they're not, but you know what? They also said that it was going to be the end of Game of Thrones, and now they're doing all these spinoffs,
right.
One of which is going to be an Arya spinoff, which is our, like, has that one, and the Jon Snow one has been officially greenlit. Mm.
Well, but the thing is that you say that this is the end. If this is the end, make it feel like the end.
Yeah.
Don't just show this subliminal stuff of this character that is literally almost everyone's favorite character survive.
Or, like, look, if you want to go for an emotional gut punch, right? And it's what we're talking for series finale stuff. If you want to go for emotional gut punch, give the emotional gut punch of her sacrificing herself, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you want to show the little light trail thing, fine. Show the light trail. But then give the definite, like, she's on the ship.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're together. They have their actual reunion. They are emotionally at peace.
Right.
That's exactly. Their ending. Don't give like a bullshit.
Why be so cryptic?
Yeah.
If it's the end.
If you're not being, if you're like, if you like clearly, even if like, so I saw the duck thing when she's looking through the plans and I was like, what the fuck is she? I missed the line trail. Mm-hmm. But like the fact that they do the flicker thing of Jinx saying the end at the end, like, come on, man.
Yeah.
But that's not sneaky. Like, what the fuck?
You know how many people you could have made happy if you showed like Jinx and Echo, just like the final thing you see is just Jinx and Echo off on an adventure on a blimp.
Yeah.
And they just give a little smirk and then it's
or
the end.
Literally like them on the back of the blimp that Caitlyn and Vi are on.
Mm-hmm.
They're on the back, chilling out on the back of the blimp, like where you shouldn't be, but they're fucking crazy. So they're just chilling out on the back of it, like tagging the back of it or something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that says the end. Or I don't fucking know. Like anything better than what the fuck they did.
Yeah, the cryptic end that didn't need to be there is just still so weird to me. The fact that like they clearly wanted people to make the connections that Jinx was alive. So why not just give everyone the peace of mind and have an actual like conclusion, resolution to the story that like it's like makes everyone feel good. You just left like literally the end of the show. Everyone ends up sad.
Yeah.
Everyone. What kind of story is that? Like everyone ends up sad. This isn't like it doesn't feel like throughout the entire series so far, it didn't feel like a show that kind of relished in people's misery.
Mm-hmm.
It tried to be so hopeful throughout, you know, like,
yeah.
Like every step, every time something went wrong, there was someone to aid, give support to the person going through what they were going through to try to show that like, we can get through this, you know, like this is like, it's not always going to be bad. Like you're not alone. And yet they ended the series with like Echo alone, Mel alone, Savika alone, like Caitlin and Vi are together, but like, there's like clearly like something looming in the future.
Mm.
Like, why? That's not the story you told this whole time.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. It bummed me out. Like, it's fantastic. That's what makes me so angry, is that it's still so good. And yet it could have been an absolute peak, absolute masterpiece. I don't know for sure, but it feels like the industry is what led to these things.
Yeah, and I know, and it reeked of executive decisions is what it reeked of.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a bummer.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe in the next series that they do, whatever it's going to be, they'll learn from their mistakes. Probably not, but, you know, maybe.
Well, you know, maybe in the next series, it'll just be a crossover and they'll have these characters in that too.
That's what I'm saying. Like, it might be another series, but there is no way Jinx being as popular as she is in that community,
mm-hmm.
and especially now the show, not a chance in hell they retire that character.
Yeah.
Not a chance.
Well, from what I've seen and from game fans is that like we know potential spinoff series coming. And one of those contains a character that in the game is Jinx's best friend. So most likely if I had to, if like I had to make a guess. Yeah. Whatever the word is, I guess. I would say that her and Echo are going to end up going on an adventure with that character or whatever. I don't know, but it's just, it's still like, doesn't excuse the weakness of the Arcane series, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they had an opportunity and they fumbled it.
I think everything should have been extended. I mean, Isha should have gotten a full season with Jinx, because Jinx has the biggest character development in the entire show, and yet everything seems to happen behind the scenes.
Yes, behind, yeah.
You know, like, she gains this incredible attachment to Isha. We only saw them a couple times together. Mm-hmm. Like, she, like, has this really dark moment after Isha's gone. We don't get to see that. Like, we don't get to see her redemption. We don't get to see her with Vi. Like,
that's what I'm saying. Like, when Vi comes down to get her out of the dungeon, mm-hmm. and she spun the fuck out, and her hair is all out, you know what I mean? And yeah. She betrays her one last time, and she's like, don't worry, I'm going to break the cycle. I'm going to make it right.
Yeah.
And she's literally suicidal, mm-hmm. and that's breaking the cycle. It's just killing herself and, like, breaking it down, like, blowing it down. Yeah. That's breaking the cycle, and then the very next scene you see her in, she's fucking on top of the world and just, like, ecstatic and... peak Jinx.
Yeah.
Like, where's what, dude? Yeah.
I know.
Like, come on.
I know. Everything should have been, we should have gotten so much more with her and all these other characters to make sense of, like, this incredible character development that she has from season, like, the beginning of season one to the end of season two.
Yeah.
I have to say, they did Echo so dirty. They did Echo so. He is literally the boy savior. He had main character vibes the entire series, and they didn't give him anything.
Yeah.
He was used, I said this to the other day, he was used as a tool throughout the entire show.
He was used as a plot device.
Yeah. In season one, he was reintroduced to as a tool to help show Caitlyn that her self-righteousness wasn't helping the Undercity. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of what led her to be a little bit more radical in Piltover. And then the next time we see him was after the bridge fight, and he was injured, was with Heimerdinger. And he was used again as a tool to show Heimerdinger that life is something that cultivates, like, happiness, creativity, and the ability for communities to thrive. Mm-hmm. Not just giving people what they need to live, but actually, like, providing a cultural, like, beneficial life worth living. Yeah. But he was only used to show Heimerdinger that, you know, and show us the audience that, so that we could see why everything that happens later is important.
Right.
And then, but that's all we got from him. He's a genius, a kid genius. Like, he was helping Heimerdinger learn stuff.
He became the new Vander.
Yeah. Like, and yet, And yet we weren't able to see it. We weren't allowed to see it, you know?
Yeah.
And then in season two, he's gone. At first he's used as a plot tool to show Jace that Jace's pursuit of magic has caused a lot of damage to other communities, to his community. Mm-hmm. And then he's ripped into another universe where we don't see him for a few episodes. Mm-hmm. Then we finally get a really good episode where it shows his potential as a person. And then he's thrown right back into the shadows until he literally saves the world.
Yeah.
It's like they treated everyone else like the main character and treated him like a background character, and all the main characters didn't do it. Like Vi didn't do anything the entire second season.
I'm gonna punch my way through everything.
But she didn't even punch
my way out of everything.
She barely fought in season two. Like, think about that. The fights.
She had her pit fighting montage. Okay.
Yeah.
Like, what, you want more than that, dude? Shit.
Dude, in season one, where she rolls up into the old bar and just rips Savika apart.
Yeah.
Bro, that fight scene is so good.
Mm-hmm.
It showed how good of a in combat she is.
Yeah.
Like, it showed how driven she is. And then in season two, like, what did she do?
Yeah.
Did she do?
Well, she got it on with Caitlyn in the dungeon.
Yeah.
While the world was about to end. Did that.
I'm a fan of that. That's just
I don't mind watching that either. That's great. But it seemed like a little ill timing. Maybe it was perfect timing. Like, if you're, you know, I don't know.
Well,
I don't know. It seemed like ill timing for your whole world to have just shattered. Your whole world's about to end. Your sister just betrayed you for the last time and all this stuff. And then all of a sudden, nah, but we're good to fuck. And it was like, come on, man. Like, emotional reunion, fine. Yeah. But like an entire like minute 45 sex scene of like going pretty fucking nude.
That scene was a lot like more aggressive too. They had to cut
it down. I'm sure it was. I'm sure the animators got all in that shit when they were doing it. I'm sure they had all the dudes, all the sweaties drawing that scene.
Yeah. Yeah.
That shit stuck out like a sore thumb to me, dude.
It did. It did to me too.
Like, I'm all for some nudity. I love some animated boobies. Let's do it. That's awesome. But god damn it, like have it at the right timing, please.
Yeah,
like that. It just wasn't the right timing for me. Yeah. I was like, "What the fuck?" Like it literally felt like, I love Spartacus. Like, Spartacus is one of my favorite series of all time. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of scenes in Spartacus where it's like you can tell they're just trying to meet their tit quota,
mm-hmm.
and they're just throwing in sex scenes, mm-hmm. right? That's what that felt like to me. It was like, we felt like we haven't made, but we know we say we're making this is an adult animation, but we feel like we haven't made it feel adult enough yet. Let's throw in a sex scene, like a pretty like an R-rated sex scene to just, you know, spice things up and show how adult we are. This is an Avatar, you know?
Yeah.
That's what it felt like. That's like, I don't know. It just kind of pissed me off.
Yeah.
There's a time and a place. That's all I'm saying.
I get it. Well, people say that, like,
maybe the end of the world. Hey, you know what? Maybe the end of the world is the time to get your fuck on.
Well, a lot of people argued that. And a lot of people also argued that we don't know how long Vi was stuck in that prison cell to, like, absorb everything that had just happened, you know?
Yeah, you're right. We don't know. Exactly. Because
they didn't show it.
Because they don't show and they don't tell. Yeah. There's no concept of time in that show. So,
yeah, I know. But do you feel at all good about the show?
I mean, I liked it, but there was, like, for me, some of that shit that I talked about, man, it totally pulled me out of it. Like, I'm not joking. Almost every time they did a montage, sucked me right out.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that I was feeling, I was like, well, I guess I'll kind of pet Hudson or do something for another couple minutes. Totally took me out of it. And because that happened so often, dude, like, it took me from loving the show to me liking the show.
Yeah. Well, I think I'm more in love with the characters than I am, like, the story I love too, but it's like the show itself, like the show in like its entirety isn't what really has given me this like passion for League of Legends universe and everything. I think it's a shame. I think it's a shame I blame the entertainment industry did to what could have been like one of the most legendary animations to come out of this side of the world, you know?
Yeah.
I think it's still good. I think it's still great. I don't know. The arc with Victor and Jace, it should have been so much longer. We should have seen way more extended, like, development. Hold on one second. Yeah. The Victor arc, it should have been, we should have seen so much more of, like, him becoming kind of like a messiah, which was so good.
It was sick. The concept of it was great.
He's like following the, it should have been so much longer. He was following this predestined path. Like he saw these like footsteps, you know, mm-hmm. this predestined path. He's like, I'm meant to do this. Something is pulling me. We see this weird, like before that, we saw like this weird disconnect between him and Jace where it's like almost like he's, you know, become like a, like someone said, Bran. He was like, he became like a Bran, you know, like, like Victor was kind of gone. It was like this new person now, mm-hmm. which was really cool. And we're like watching this play out. Then he goes to that like old decrepit, like, location in the Undercity with all those sick, and he starts healing people, and you're like, oh my god, this is incredible. And then the next time you see it, like, he's a little bit more, like, even more disconnected, but yet more holy in this sense. And we should have gotten more of that to see, like, the potential, like, the scene of him slowly working with Vander, mm-hmm. like, was so good, and we should have just, everything should have been extended.
You know, to go back to the relationship thing real quick, two relationships that I wanted to see more of, whenever his assistant dies, when she comes in there to like tell him that she loves him and that she wants to be a partner with him and has these ideas, and she gets killed by the Arcane, that fucking hurt. Like, I felt so fucking bad for Victor.
Yeah.
And what that did to his character. But then when they're in the whatever space, I don't know what you whatever that's called. I don't know. I don't know if they ever say what it's called. When she's there again, I was so happy that she was there in that form of consciousness. But I wanted to see more of that interaction with them too. And like the little bit at the end where he's like, I'll miss our talks. I'll miss our conversations. She says, no, you won't.
Yeah.
It was like, I want more. Yeah. Give me more.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, God, it's just the whole thing. Like, shit, it was so condensed.
Yeah.
It was so condensed. So condensed. And it did not need to be.
No. No. If everything, so I don't know how much more you want to talk about it.
I know. I mean, it kind of feels like we're going in circles, but it's just,
I have this picture of a perfect ending. And that's to say with the idea that everything was extended and developed the way it was needed, but with all the exact, like, no changes to plot. I don't see anything wrong with what happened in the show. Mm-hmm. Like there's so many things when we talk about Game of Thrones, everything is wrong. The way everything ends is wrong. Everything's wrong. It just is wrong. This show, everything is right. Really. Mm-hmm. Everything is done right. It was just condensed.
It was how they got there.
Yeah, it was how they got there.
You didn't see it.
Exactly. And so there's nothing I want to change as far as the plot goes. I think the people who died, I understand how meaningful it is for them to die. People who got together, I understand why they got together. People who got split up, I understand why they split up. Like, for instance, Jace and Mel, right? Mm. Obviously. They didn't reveal anything. They didn't go into detail about it, but clearly they're not together anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, they didn't show anything about that. But clearly Mel, when Mel came back and saw Jace and he had changed, like, there's nothing there anymore.
No,
you know?
Yeah. I think more so him, but they're both totally different people.
Right.
After when they come back together.
Right.
Like, exactly. Different beings.
Yeah. And his purpose, like, his new identity is his purpose to save world.
Yeah. That's it.
So he doesn't have any room. And I get it. They should have showed more, but I get it, you know?
Yeah, when he comes back as old Kyle Reese looking ass. Dude. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Good God.
I know. When he shows up and he's like, quiet. And he rolls in and he's got that like big shoulder
armor.
Oh my God, he looks so sick.
I mean, he does look awesome, but they straight up made him Kyle Reese in Terminator. Like, he is Kyle Reese. Like, straight up.
So sick. Yeah. Anyways, but I have how they should have ended it. Mm. With the idea, if we're going in understanding that nothing changes except everything is flushed out more to the extent that it needed to be. So we got more with all the characters, but the plot stays the same.
Right.
How I see they should have ended it in that final episode of season three, right? Yeah. We in the episode flashback, or I guess flashback episode of Echo in his alternate universe, when they played Spin the Wheel, first of all, we haven't talked about that, but I love that song so much.
Which one? Spin the Wheel?
Spin the Wheel. That's the banjo song.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
that's the folk song. It's so good. I love it so much. I love that it's sung by one of the characters. And I love like that. It's like, it has this like happy yet melancholy sound to it.
Oh, it's very melancholy.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's also hopeful because it's like, you know, the song is about like, just live. Like things are going to go bad. Things are going to go good. That's part of it. You know, you just have to like enjoy the fact that you're getting a journey. You're getting an experience. You're getting a story, you know?
Yeah.
And it's so good. And it like makes sense for the show, you know, especially like its notes on like, you know, time, how like, you know, you can't really turn back time, but you can turn back in as far as like enjoying those memories. But in that scene, Echo is traversing what is new Piltover and Zahn side by side in this like harmony.
Yeah.
In my opinion, take out Heimerdinger's song completely, right? Take out Heimerdinger in that moment. Make it all about Echo exploring this new harmonious world. Mm. And like, if we're an extended universe or an extended series, like unlike what we got, we get to see more of him explore and like realize how good this place is. He goes back and decides, that's why he decides to be more friendly to Powder and all this. He's like, this is actually really good. I've been thinking about this all wrong, you know? And then he goes back, makes up with Powder, has more of an extended journey there where he's like, I don't want to leave. You're right. I want to stay a little bit longer. And then maybe something happens and he's like, okay, I have to go. I have to go help. You know, this isn't my place.
Yeah.
But we get all of that in a more developed story. So push back to the end of the series. It ends the exact same way we got the in season or episode 9 of season 2. But we're here. What I think they should have done is it starts with kind of showing where all the characters are. Mm-hmm. And it starts playing Spin the Wheel. That's where I think it does it. It shows all the characters kind of where they are now, you know? But I just think they show a little bit more happiness. Like, I think they show everything. Like it shows Caitlin doing her research. And then when it shows her see the air ducts, give us Jinx, right? Just show us. Just like whenever she smirks, like she smirks and then she stands up and it shows goes back to the computer screen showing those air ducts and just shows you there. And then she goes and talks to Vi and she like, you know, it's like, we're still together. We're still going strong. Everything's good here. Then it goes and it's still like playing Spin the Wheel and it goes and it shows like Mel. She's off on the airships to like go lead. What's it called?
Tharia?
I forget the name of her country, home country.
The Spartan people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then it shows Echo and he's like by himself, but he's got that piece of paper. And in the show, it was like, he was like burning like an incense or whatever, kind of like everyone else was for Jinx. But you like open it and it's for Heimerdinger. And he gets up and he packs up and he meets Jinx on the airship. Hmm. And then as Spin the Wheel's playing, him and Jinx take off. And they should have ended it like that.
Yeah. But they didn't.
But they didn't.
But they did.
I think Spin the Wheel should have been the ending of the show. Oh, and then at the end, what I said was after like at the end of the song, they flash back to Heimerdinger playing the song in the courtyard.
and he's like, he's chilling. He's with those kids and stuff.
Yeah.
That's how they should have ended the show.
Yeah. Should have been in the writer's room, dude.
You know what's really cool though? I've actually feel a lot better because there have been some like artists that have redrawn these like comic strips of the ending.
Oh, that's cool.
And like some other scenes, like there's a comic strip of that someone drew of Echo and Jinx whenever he goes to save her. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it shows like this romantic, like they're like holding each other and painting on each other. It's really cute. And it's like, ah, that's canon. So any final remarks about the show before we move on from the discussion?
No, I think I've said all I wanted to say on it.
Yeah. I just want to say that I give a lot of praise to everyone involved into the creative making of the show.
Yeah.
Voice acting, like voice actors, like we said, writers, the illustration art team, like even the people who made the score, apart from, you know, the kind of forced music videos or soundtrack.
Or all the Imagine Dragons.
Well, yeah. The Imagine Dragons is related to League of Legends. Like they were the main song for one of the seasons or something. That
I should have chosen a different song.
I think that song is the, like, was the song of season two or something like that.
Yeah.
Of League of Legends. Anyways. So, you know, big props to everyone who absolutely made an incredible story. And like, I can't wait to see what like all these people do next. Like if we get spinoff series, like, you know, I'm really excited to see these illustrators get back to work and stuff. And all these voice actors, like, I didn't know any of these people had it in them. And I'm really excited to see what they do next, you know.
You want to switch gears to Dandadan?
Yeah, we can talk about Dandadan real quick. Not as much of a topic or discussion topic, but I think it's really worth the discussion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you said that you're on episode 7. That was the last one you saw.
No. I'm
You haven't seen episode 7?
Yes, I have. I just haven't seen the most recent episode.
Yeah, so 8 or 9.
No, I think it's 9.
Yeah. 9. Okay. Yeah, right.
It's getting dark in here.
7 is where you find out the backstory of the ballerina.
Of Silky, yeah.
Silky. Yeah.
So for me, the reason I want to bring this up, Dandadan has been great so far. So good. Everyone loves it. It's funny. The animation is crazy. Pops off every episode. Mm-hmm. It's just really well done. But up until episode 7, it's like has this kind of like fully coolly Mob Psycho kind of vibe. It's kind of chaotic, you know, kind of this like teen adventure story, you know, dealing with like chaos and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then we got episode 7 and it just like did this hard switch and it made me realize that I was watching a different show than what I originally thought, you know? And I think that's kind of what I want to talk about. Because I think it went from being a show that I was going to love that, it's just going to be a wonderful, you know, action packed, like action comedy kind of thing, mm-hmm. to being something completely different, like to being a show that's going to, if they keep up with this pace, which, you know, a lot of people believe they will, could end up being one of the greatest shows I've seen in a while, you know, like,
yeah,
that has depth to it and like, reaches into some really harsh topics, you know, and shows the dark side of the world in a way that like also somehow celebrates humanity. It's incredible.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I mean, the show as a whole. So as soon as we started watching it, I was like, it's the same studio that did Spooly Cooly. Right.
Is it?
I think so.
I know they did. I know they did. Keep Your Hands Off Azekin.
Yeah, and I think it's the same one that did Billy Cooley. I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure it is.
I can look it up real quick.
But it gave me that vibe. It's like that tale of like adolescence and coming of age, and in this weird world of demons and ghosts and aliens and crazy hijinks and like the most teenager of humors that you could have, you know what I mean? Like, give me your banana, you know, like it's really silly and it is really, really funny. But then it also peppered in this like unbelievably cute relationship dynamic between the two protagonists that was like it was like watching My Love Story.
Mm-hmm.
It is what I akin it to. It's like, it's so sweet when you're like, oh my God, not only did I ship the shit out of these guys, but like, I really hope that they come together in the end.
Yeah.
Their relationship seems pretty like genuine of like these, like even like the little misunderstandings that happen, you know, like when what's her face is introduced.
Yeah.
And you know, like, neither one of them still say what they feel, but like, you know, she's automatically jealous and everything.
Yeah.
But then you still got the backdrop of this like wild world of aliens and ghosts.
Yeah. And I think what's incredible that they did in episode 7 is that that's the world we thought we had. This like, you got teen angst mixed with sci-fi or supernatural.
Yeah.
And it's like, that's a great story. And then like they did a little something that kind of surprised me with Turbo Granny, right? Where when they defeat Turbo Granny on top of the train, it kind of reveals that like she was helping
souls.
Yeah, for of these like girls that had been attacked and you know, whatever. And you're like, wow, that's pretty heavy. That's really sweet. Then the next time you see her, when she's been reanimated into the cat or whatever, and they're like fighting her in the house. I forget the main character, the girl's name, but she's like, I can't hate you, you know, because of, you
what
know,
what you did for those spirits.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. And that was really that was really touching. And then we got episode 7. And it shows this backstory of Silky. And first of all, the way they did that with like no words spoken, it was just this like classical, like this like sad classical song that was beautiful, showing this like wonderful yet tragic life.
You want to see a montage? Yeah. You want to see how to use Soviet montage, bro?
Yeah.
God damn.
Like, the way we're like rotating. Like, ugh. Around this family, this small intimate family, as like she's doing literally everything she can to be a good mother,
like giving, like not just giving like a piece of her, but like giving all of her to her daughter, like even down to the point where she's trying to like give her the one thing that she like literally has to give, which is like her dance and showing her how, you know, and then giving everything that she can so that the little girl can dance and like has an outfit and everything.
Like she sacrifices her body. She sacrifices
literally,
her mind.
Yeah. Literally. Dude. Yeah.
I mean, she gives up everything. And then to see like, you know, the tragedy that like, unfolds later on, it was so beautifully done. And it was so shocking because I didn't know this show would go there. First of all, I also didn't know it would go there so beautifully and so like masterfully, like
paying all the respects.
Yeah.
Like not, there's no like joking or anything. There's no like cheaping out and making like some little gag out of it to try to like put some levity in the mood. It's like, no, this is pure drama.
Yeah.
This is heartbreak.
Yeah.
This is devastation, and we're going to like explore this, this theme like to its entirety.
Yeah. And I think like
we're committing to it.
Right. And it was kind of like saying like, no, shut up. Like this is real. Like people are hurting.
Yeah.
And it made it like, it just changed the dynamic of the show for me, where now I have to prepare myself, because now I, even if I'm watching an episode that isn't like that, if it, you know, like the next episode, episode 8, kind of returned back to its normal levity. Mm-hmm. And yet I still have this like pit in my stomach, because now I see what the story is, you know, like it's more than that. It's like, you know, this is about human experience and about the fragility of like life and
the fragility of existence.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so good. So good. And I don't know if it's going to continue on the same path as far as like, so I know that we're going to get more episodes like that moving forward. I think they're on this path to show that like, yes, this is a show about aliens and like ghosts, but like these ghosts, they're not just scary ghosts. Like these are people that are like unable to pass on because they've experienced something really tragic, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I think the ghost and the, there's so much subtext in everything about this show. Like I watched a little thing on even the opening credits and like all the homages that they're paying to all these different factors of other anime or different forms of media and everything. But there's also these themes of like the ghosts aren't just ghosts. The aliens aren't just aliens. Like they're representations of actual types of people.
Yeah.
In real life, you know? Right. And it's like for good or for worse.
Yeah.
And like to be able to tackle something like this show while also keeping that like crazy energy that they do, that's that tightrope. That's that line that like the good shows try to do and great shows execute. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. The one thing that I'm curious about is, you know, we have probably one of the strongest female leads that we've had in anime in a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And this isn't the first time. So this is the studio that did Devilman Crybaby.
Yeah.
But they also did Keep Your Hands Waterfall. Off Azuken. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But they did Keep Your Hands Off Azuken, which is, you know, about an all-girls school. It celebrates like these diverse female characters and their like ability to be creative and like have these independent strengths and stuff like that. And so I see that kind of carrying over into this show with such a strong female lead, a strong side character female as the granny. Mm-hmm. And then in addition to that, what seems, I don't know how long it's going to continue, if they'll show kind of other scenarios as well, but it does seem to be focusing on the mistreatment of women in this, in life, you know?
I mean, yeah.
So I wonder if that's going to be kind of a string of thought they have that continue, or if they'll kind of go over like, oh, this is about, you know, the neglect of, like children or the abuse of the homeless or whatever it is, you know, or if it's going to be kind of like a representation of the brutality towards women, you know, I'm here for it. They're doing a very good job, but I'm just curious.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I think, I wanted to bring it up because that episode shocked me in more than just the story. It shocked me in a form of storytelling that I didn't expect to see from the show, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that it does that thing that Fooly Cooly does in a sense where it has all these hijinks and it's got this like insane story of like, like sometimes just nonsense, like there's just nonsense happening. And in that you have these themes of like isolation and loneliness and feeling like, and like depression and like these feelings of just like emptiness.
Yeah.
and not knowing how to express it. And that's what brings like Fooly Cooly from being a great show or to a good show to be a great show. And that's what this show does, or with episode 7, that's what this does. Right. And like the next two episodes get crazy again. I told you, like episode 9, I was watching it and Shelby was like, that felt like a fucking fever dream. Like yeah. She's never seen the show. So she was just like, I have no idea what's going on. And it's heightened up again. It's what it's what you air quotes expect from the show. Right. But to know that they have the ability to stick a landing like that in the midst of all that chaos, dog, chef's kiss.
Yeah.
It's like everything that I want in an anime.
I know. I'm
really... you got a banger intro?
Yeah, dude.
And you got a banger intro? Come on, cuh. Like,
I'm so curious on how this show continues. I hope it gets a full run. You know, I think it will.
Yeah.
But
I'll say this. I really hope with the backlash of what happened with JJK season 2 and the movie, I really hope that they kind of learn with how big that show is. It might not. The anime industry is what it is, and it is the way that it is for a reason. But I really hope that they start to learn.
Well, this is a smaller studio. So.
Yeah, but.
Science Story only has a few titles. They only have 22 titles. So they're smaller.
Okay. Well, I hope that they're ran in a different way.
Yeah.
Than like MAPPA is.
I mean, they've only put out bangers. They've only put out bangers.
Yeah. So I'm hoping if I don't know how long the manga goes, right? So if this is like a longer running series.
Yeah.
Like longer running meaning like 3 seasons. I don't know. Yeah. I'm hoping that they take the time and give the animators a proper schedule and a proper break they need in between seasons.
Yeah.
So that the people don't suffer, like the animators and the people working on the show don't suffer, but so that also the craft itself doesn't suffer.
Right.
The art doesn't suffer.
Yeah.
At the expense of monetary, at the expense of immediate monetary gain.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's so good. It's fantastic, though.
So good.
I absolutely love it. I was blown away. It's one of those that I was like, I had seen whenever they released an initial like press for it and previews for it, I didn't see a trailer, but I saw a clip. From one of the early fight scenes. And I was like, it looks crazy. Like, it looks really, really good. But usually, like, you know how I am. Like, when stuff gets really hyped up, I won't watch it. But I'm really glad that I did watch it, on release. Because it's sick.
Yeah.
It's like, and it's fantastic.
Joey told me, I'll share this. Joey told me that the writer watched 100 romance anime or read 100 romance manga to prepare for this.
That's
fun. So I think a lot of care and like preparation has gone into it. So I'm really excited to see. I wanted to talk about this whenever that episode released, but obviously we have to record when we can. But I just wanted to like throw that out there. We'll talk more as we finish the show and stuff. But
yeah, I definitely want to do a season wrap up.
Yeah,
whenever it's done.
Yeah,
I'm sure it'll lend itself to it.
I think anyone who hasn't tried it yet should. It needs to get more attention. Like people
totally recommend it. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Like Devilman Crybaby, it looks like has over a million reactions on my anime list. And then Dandadan has 500,000. So
really, because I would really,
That's just reactions on anime list. My anime.
What do you
list.
Mean reactions?
Like ratings, like people ratings? That have, okay. like people have rated it and stuff.
But see, I would, that actually does shock me because Devilman Crybaby came out, 2017, 2018?
Yeah. Something like that.
And like Devilman Crybaby, I love that. I love that anime. I think it is such a breath of fresh air in the mass flooding of anime that comes out now. Yeah. When that came out, it was so different than everything else coming out at the same time.
Yeah.
But I consider that almost fringe. Like I consider it like maybe a cult classic.
Yeah.
But it's not a JJK. It's not, you know,
Well, it aired on Netflix. It aired on Netflix when it came out. And I think it was so shocking. And it's like, you know,
content. I mean, some of it. Oh, I mean, it's like an X-rated acid trip at some points. Yeah. Like it's fucking crazy.
Yeah. I think people that maybe not like were not into anime as much got wind of it because of how shocking it was. And everyone was trying to like jump onto the shock value.
Yeah.
So it got a lot of attention, but I think Dandadan deserves like anybody who's watching anime who hasn't started it yet. Like, I think this is going to be industry changing or industry influencing, you know,
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
So cool. So cool.
It is. It's fantastic. I hope that it keeps the pace and the quality that it's maintaining now. I hope it maintains that throughout the series.
Yeah, I think, I mean, I'm holding out really strong hope that it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's cool. We're in an awesome age of animation, dude.
We are.
It's so fucking awesome to not only have like this kind of animation coming out all the time, but to have access to it.
Sorry.
It's fine.
To have
access to it is like, you know, think about how it was in the 90s, like before the internet was the way it is. Like we were watching shows in the 90s that came out in the 80s, like on a new release basis, because that's what we were getting. Imagine having to wait 10 years to watch Dandadan.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's so fucking rad that we're able to see these amazing shows as literally as they drop.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's a great time to be alive.
Yeah. It's funny, too, because I like as I'm watching Dandadan, I'm also watching The Perfect Tank.
What's that? Oh, is that like, Isekai?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. That's funny.
Yeah. I know. Yeah, man.
Yeah, it's cool. Well, I think that's pretty good. You want to go ahead and wrap it up?
Yeah.
Okay. That was a fun talk.
Yeah. Next time. I mean, it's December 1st. So we are officially in the Christmas season.
Yeah.
So maybe next episode we talk about some Christmas vibes.
Yeah. Some Christmas vibes. Maybe some winter anime that makes you feel just good when you're watching it.
Mm-hmm.
Makes you want to snuggle up with some hot cocoa. And
yeah.
And that's fire.
Yeah, we haven't talked about Pokemon in a while, so I'll be doing a tournament next Sunday, so maybe we cover some Pokemon next summer.
If you end up going to that tournament, maybe I'll go to a tournament as well.
Yeah.
That should be off next Sunday, yeah.
All right, everyone, thanks for hanging out with us. Hope you enjoyed the episode. You can catch this recording on Spotify, on Amazon, on Apple, on, what do you call it?
That's YouTube. The WikiLeaks?
Whatever you call it.
Definitely didn't say that. Yeah, you had it. That was it.
Yeah.
That's the big ones. Yeah.
Yeah. This is our second. Are you going to do video recording for this one?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So this is our second video recording. This will also be on YouTube. Mm-hmm. And you can follow the link tree below to get all of our other socials. I do have a Twitch you can check out. The Born2BNerd YouTube channel, TikTok.
You can check me out at Throttle Fox Moto Photo on YouTube, a fun little moto vlog channel that I started. Like and subscribe to that if you wanted. That'd be fucking rad.
Yeah, we are. You want to mention real quick our Japan trip coming up?
Well, I don't know. Do we? I fuck it. Yeah, we're going to Japan, guys. It's going to be really fucking cool.
We can talk more into detail. Actually, maybe that would be a fun topic to talk about, but you'll be vlogging. I'm sure you'll be doing some photoing and stuff there.
Yeah, I'll definitely be taking a lot of photos. I don't know how much of it I will put in my vlogs.
Yeah.
Of the vlog.
Well, because you want to do the drag race thing, right? Or the street,
right? Oh, we're not talking about street racing, Lance. I don't do street racing. That's illegal.
Okay.
We don't talk about that. That's not, that's not something that I partake in.
But we're going into like some car shows or whatever.
I mean, yeah, we're definitely going to go to Daikoku.
Yeah. That's what I mean. It was like, yeah. So you'll be, I don't know if you were planning on putting any of that on your channel.
Yeah, we'll see. I'm not sure if it will or not.
Yeah.
But
yeah. Well, keep your ears off for that, because we'll be sharing a lot of stuff about it. I don't know.
All right, guys. Well, that's going to be the end of this one. Thank you so much for listening. We will catch you next time.
Bye.
Bye.